Y'all don't mind. Let's go back to a time when we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, the Spirit and in truth.
I love them old church.
That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing.
You knew exactly what he was gonna say. Sisters got happy.
I love them old church.
Folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and
singing.
All of a sudden, he break off in a song, something like this.
Let me talk to you briefly, and I'm going to let you go home. God heard your cry. We've been in the sauna for the last 3-4 weeks, and God has blessed us today with some air conditioning. Y'all about to say amen.
Man.
That ought to be enough for everybody to just start shouting right now. Thank
amen.
You. Y'all sitting here now, you can take your coat off if you want to. Amen.
Amen.
And then y'all feel it there? Somebody ought to shout glory this morning. I remember getting up here preaching while I was sweating. I said, ooh, I didn't even like to sweat like that still. I got to be out there. It was hot in here. Amen. So God has blessed us. If you have your Bibles, have your copy of God's Word, if you hold them up high to you, and all phones should be with moms and dads. And we went back to the old book. If you got a phone right there, that's okay. Next week, bring your Bible. We went back to the book. And the reason I say it is because with them phones, you hold it up saying that's for your scriptures, and the next thing you know, you send out a text message and getting emails and everything else, and think us old folk crazy. We're not
man.
Crazy. We just don't have time to be messing with you, but we know what you're doing. Amen.
Man.
And so just for a little while, we're going to let Facebook rest. Make sure you post that you're here. We're going to let Facebook work. We're going to have church. Amen.
Man.
Amen. Let me first do what we always did in the Church of Christ. Until these recent years, and then make sure that the text was rightly divided. It's called treating the text. And our text is coming from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. What makes us different than other churches is that we actually let you know what we're preaching about, why we're preaching about it, where it came from, the facts of the text before we get into the implications of the text. And so we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1, though I speak with the tongues of men and the tongues of angels, and have not God, I become as a sounding brass, a timbrel, and singing. We read, but why is Paul, that's the author of the text, why is Paul writing to the church? That's whom he's writing to, the church of Corinth. He is writing to the church of Corinth because of the fraction and the division that is in the church. And in particular, he is writing to the church of Corinth. And that's why you can't just go to a text and say whatever you want to. Whatever you preach about must be consistent with what Paul is preaching about.
Amen.
You just can't go to a text and just start preaching and just say something, and then the church at Corinth and Paul wouldn't understand what you were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
We call that socking the scripture. You know what socking the scripture is?
Straight out of context.
Straight out of context. Amen. So we want to stay in context. Amen. And so why is Paul saying, though I speak with the tongues of men, the tongues of angels, and don't have love, I come to the sound of bread, timber, and sin. He is saying because there is confusion, starting in chapter 12, concerning the diversities of gifts in which God had given some men and women who were gifted with the gifts of the Holy Spirit. He says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 3, wherefore I gave you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus the Christ. That no man can say that Jesus is the Lord, but by the Holy Ghost. Now there are diversities, verse 4, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit.
Man.
He wanted them to understand that these gifts did not elevate one past the other person. That just because some had the gift to preach, to teach,
uh-huh,
to prophesy,
well,
to speak in tongues, whatever that it may be, it did not make them any better than anyone else.
Man.
But they were gifted individuals. And while we respect the gifts of the manifestation of the Holy Spirit in their life, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 12, we are still one body.
Man.
We are that one body which have many members. That by the one body is one body, so also is Christ. And then he begins to, and skipping 13, verse 14, he begins to deal with the functionality of the body. Back to verse 12.
Yes.
Chapter 12. He starts about the eye and the foot and the head. And then in verse 26, whether one suffered, one member, we all suffer.
Man.
Meaning that whether one suffer, we all suffer. And then in verse 29, he says, are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles, have all the gifts of healing, do all speak in tongues, do all interpret. And then he finally says, let me help you stop fighting in the church. Let me help you stop elevating yourself in the church. Let me tell you something. The one thing that if the church don't have this, the church is not going anywhere at all. And that's relevant today. If a church without love for God,
well,
the church is a whole lot of trouble.
Amen.
A church that does not desire to love God,
yes,
more,
sir,
for he's worthy to be loved. For God loved us first before we loved him.
Amen.
He had a love for us that while we were yet in sin, he died
for
our ungodliness.
Amen.
Something in life, it's not that you want to be better than somebody. It's not that you want to achieve the most highest accomplishments in life. He said the thing that you ought to desire the most in life is the covet, the gift, to know how to love like God.
Man.
Y'all ought to say amen.
Man.
If you can learn, if you can live this life and learn how to love folk that don't love you, you're going to be all right. If you can live this life and learn how to love God so much that it aches you down in your soul to think about not being in service, you're going to be all right. If you reach a point where you love God so much that when you go to bed at night, you just have to shout, thank you, Jesus, for the day you had, you're going to be all right. But the problem with the church of Corinth is that they love the stuff that they had, they love the things they could do more than they love God himself, and allow the gifts that God gave them to become a mess in the house of God.
Man.
And I tremble sometimes when I think about the necessity and the importance of this letter, because it is still apropos today. Folks still love this world more than they love God. Amen.
Man.
In John chapter 3, he said there were men who loved darkness more than they loved God.
Yes.
There are folks that love the good times of the world more than they love God. There are preachers who love their orator ability more than they love God. There are folk who love to sing and praise God more than they love God himself.
Man.
Praising themselves. But until we learn to love God, and if I ask you right now, how many of you love God? Hands would shout up in the air. But how consistent is your love?
Mm.
How consistent your love? Do you find yourself thinking about how sweet it's going to be on that notable day when God comes back? To finally look at the hands with holes in them. To finally look at him that was pierced in the side. To finally look at him that died on Calvary's cross for your sins and mine. How many of us really truly love God?
Man.
A church that doesn't love God will fight and raise hell all through the day. A church that doesn't love God, as long as they can meet and organize and plan and do things according to their gifts and ability and understanding, they'll formulate and they'll rotate exasperated numbers, but the love of God never enters their mind.
Man.
A church that loves God will break up and split into 1,000 pieces because of one gift or another. A church that does not love God will deny God even his presence in the worship house.
Man.
God, and Paul said, I gotta talk to you because there's something wrong with you. I stopped by in chapter 5, from chapter 5, and I see that you have a man that's in the church that doesn't love God, that wants to have his father's wife, and I heard there's a fornicator among you that's not even like those out in the world. And I stopped by chapter 6, and I see that you're fighting and you're arguing so much that you're taking each other to court and you're suing one another at the law instead of loving God. Have to sit down and talk and resolve the issue. And I stopped by chapter 7, and I'm looking, I see that marriages are breaking up and marriages are falling to pieces because somebody don't love God enough to stay with his spouse and work through the rough times. And I stop by chapter 8 and I see we're still struggling loving God. And I get to chapter 12 and you're in the house fighting. In chapter 11 you're fighting about communion and you're upset with your division amongst, and I partly believe it. And Father, I gotta tell you that the whole problem of the church in Corinth is somebody don't love God.
Man.
And so he said, though I speak with the tongues of men and the tongues of angels, have not love, I become a sounding brass and a tingling cymbal. And though I understand all mission, though I have all knowledge, and though I have all faith so I can move mountains, and I don't have love, it profits me nothing. And though I take everything that I got, all my money, to feed the poor, though I give my body to be burned, and I don't have love, it profits me nothing.
Man.
In other words, he says to them, it's not how much you know that makes you love God. It's not how much you can buy that makes you love God. And how much you do that love God. It's when you stand with God through the hell, the ups and the bad love of God, you have to have a purpose in your Christianity. Not only must there be a purpose, there must be a persistence, a passion in your Christianity. And lastly, in this text you'll find, it says the love of God must be perfected. It has to have perfection. Oh yes, he is clear that it's not how much we talk about loving God. There are a lot of folk that got a lot of tongue service, but don't have a lot of action in their love.
Man.
You know, God in his wisdom shows us through James chapter 2, 14 to 16, men say have faith. He said, let me tell you something. Yeah, you say you have faith, but show me your faith. I'll show you my faith by my word. You've been talking about how much you love God, but where's your love to God and the kingdom of God concerning the building of his kingdom here at the end?
Man.
Oh, yes, yes. And I look at this and I say, yeah, we have a whole lot of folk talking about they love God. But all but in their works, they deny him, being reprobates. Titus chapter 2. He says that they are reprobates in all things. And then we look at the second verse. He says that though I have to speak the tongue and gift of prophecy, is not how intelligent we are. Some of us, as long as somebody sounds good, we start going, oh yeah, that must be a man of God. But let me tell you something, the devil can sound good.
Amen.
But I say again, the devil can sound good. The devil can speak Greek, he speak Hebrew, whatever you want. He can sound good. It's not how good he sounds. It's not how knowledgeable Brother Hamilton is. It's not his memory ability. It's not his study habit. It's when he studies, does he put to work what he studies?
Amen.
He must have a purpose in his life. Because I'm going to tell you something. If you don't love, I don't care whatever, if you don't love, truly love, whatever you're doing, you're not going to do it alone.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody said, well, why do people leave the church? Well, they leave the church, they fall away because of love problems for God. If you could point to one reason that you would break up with God, would you raise your hand? I'd like to hear that. That you would break up with God, I'd like to hear that. If you could point to one instance that God had let you down, I'd like to hear that. Is it because he woke you up this morning, you upset with him, he woke you up too early, that you're mad at him? Is it because he fed you too well and filled your icebox? Is it because he kept your job that you're mad at him? Did there were people laid off and you didn't get laid off and you mad because you didn't get laid off and you wanted to go to the beach? Well, I mean, what are you mad at? Why don't you love him? Y'all are saying, I'm trying to help you. I'm trying to find it. Okay, now watch this. First, the first P is that we must understand that with love comes purpose. Purpose is motivated, it is cemented by the love that we have. In other words, to be talented with no purpose is to simply preach as a sounding brass or tinkling cymbal. It is to just be making noise if you have no purpose. If I'm preaching and I'm just preaching so you can hear me and folk are not saved, I ought to stop preaching.
Man.
If y'all ought to say amen.
Man.
If I'm preaching just to show I can preach, just to show I know how to preach, and folk are not being warned of God's impending judgment, and folk are not being warned of the glory of God in Revelation 21 and 22, and the judgment of God, 1 Peter 4, verse number 17, and the repentance of God from Acts 17 and verse number 31, we preach not ourselves, but we preach Christ Jesus. And if I'm preaching anything else but Jesus and the kingdom of God, I'm nothing but a sounding brass and timbaling cymbal, because nothing that I'm preaching is helping you come closer to God.
Man.
I'm preaching not myself, but preaching the gospel of God, warning men to get your life right before it's too late. You might not like it, but I'm preaching it in love for Jesus Christ and the kingdom of God. For God not be able to come to the house of God and hear some philosophical rendition of the gospel. They ought to know that Jesus Christ, according to Romans chapter 15, beginning at verse number 1, died for our sins. The gospel says, around the 5th verse, that the gospel is this, that verse number 3, first I deliver to you, first of all, how that Christ was received up, that he died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again on the 3rd day according to the scriptures.
Man.
You need to understand that when he died on Calvary's cross, he didn't just die so folk could just keep on living and seeing.
Well.
But when he died on Calvary's cross, they didn't know it was because of love that he died on Calvary's cross and nothing else.
Right.
Love the world.
Yes, sir.
He gave his only begotten son. They need to know that that love prepared a way from earth back to glory. The Bible says, take heed unto yourselves and to the Holy Ghost, which he has made you overseers, that you would feed the church of God, which he has purchased with the blood. They need to know that when he died on Calvary's cross, he purchased his church. He didn't purchase everybody. He didn't purchase every assembly.
Amen.
Chapter 1, verse number 19 or so, he said, "For much you know, you will not redeem with such corruptible things, such as silver and gold, from the vain tradition of your father, but you will purchase by the blood of Jesus Christ."
Amen.
God, there ain't too much you wouldn't do for the kingdom of God.
Amen.
And perhaps, as I come to a close, that the problem that we face today is that folk have fallen out of love with God.
Well.
And once you are not in love, you forget the purpose in which God has called you into this relationship. God has called you, according to 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9, out of darkness into the marvelous light.
Preach.
He called you by a preacher who loved you. In Acts chapter 16, verse 26 through 28, 16 through 18, he called you when he called Paul. He said, Paul, let me tell you something. Arise and get on your feet. Now listen to the verb. He says, arise and get on your feet, for I have called you to be a minister for this purpose. A minister who has been called to the gospel preaches with purpose. His purpose is not to befriend you. His purpose is not for you to like him. His purpose is not to tell you what you want to hear, but his purpose is to bring you out of darkness into the marvelous light, as he has been brought out of the darkness of the marvelous light. Who has Acts chapter? Let's get there very quickly. Acts chapter 26, verse 16 through 18. Very quickly, I can quote it, but I want you to look at it. Because he said, watch, he says, but arise and stand on thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose. He is a man of purpose to make thee a minister and to witness to both these things that I have seen and the things that shall appear unto thee, delivering thee from the people, from the Gentiles, unto whom I now send thee, to open the eyes to them that are turned from darkness to light, from the powers of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sin and an inheritance among them which are sanctified by the faith that is in me. Jesus says that I called you out to preach, not to preach popularity. I called you to preach, not to preach philosophically. I called you to preach, not to mention my church. I called you to preach, the gospel of forgiveness of what? Of sin.
Man.
Every Sunday morning you come to the house of God.
Yes, sir.
Folks out here about the church, they're out here about forgiveness, they're out here about Jesus, and they're out here about the distinct ability of your love relationship with God for which you are called. And if you're not going to preach that, you're but sound in brass and tingling cymbals.
Man.
And doesn't do anybody any good. And so what happens? What happens then is that you have years of this in which churches go without preaching the distinct ability of Christ's love. And churches begin to drift away from the gospel of Christ. And churches begin to start to mimic the men kind churches of this world. You'll see us start to imitate our worship service, to imitate folk out in the world. You'll see our preachers leave off the plan of salvation at the end of the sermon. Your whole purpose for preaching was to invite somebody into a relationship with God. You'll see our members' minds drift as they're allowed to live sinfully and lustfully and covetedly in this world and think any kind of way they want without being induced with the word of God that will make them stop for a minute and say, perhaps this thing I'm doing is not right. You'll start to see the disrespect to the man of God because he sounds just like everybody else. You'll start to see homosexuality invade the church. You'll start to see narcissism invade the church, men that are more about themselves than they are the cause of Christ. You'll start to see money hungry, laundering, stealing right in the house of God, and folks think nothing about it. You'll see post attendance drop to an all-time low because the love has waxed cold for God. You see, the reason I came to the house of God was never because of you, you, and you, but I came to God because I'm in love, and I just want to see him one time. I just want to hear a song about it.
Man.
I came to the house of God because he showed enough love me.
Yes,
in spite of myself. I didn't come here for no other reason but because I love the Lord.
Man.
For the love of God, nothing can stop him. Lest we live in this world in 2014, 2015. We live in a world now whose love has waxed cold. And the enemy is in full deception mode. Folk are fighting, just like they were fighting in the beginning of this text. Folk are arguing, folk are leaving, folk are breaking up. I like what he says about love. He said, love suffered long and this happened. Now let me say this before I close, because I'm not telling you to be in an abusive relationship. I'm not telling you you ought to be with somebody who don't love you. You do that. The devil don't love you. Devil don't care nothing about you. He trick you with those gifts, those flowers. He just want one thing, that's your soul. Just like your boyfriend, sometimes your people you think you love, they don't love you. If they love you, they would have you cheat on God. If they
Amen.
I don't love you. I'm not asking you to stay in an abusive relationship where the devil is beating the hell out of you. But the devil keep playing with you. Give you this, take it back. Yeah.
Man.
You look up, somebody smiling, shining, everything that shine ain't gold. He was nice at first. He was fine. He was built.
Wow.
He was muscular. I'm asking you to love somebody that love you just like you are.
Man.
Somebody don't change when you start having children.
Yeah.
I'm not somebody that loves you that don't change when you're not at your best. I'm talking about a spirit that loves you when you're at your absolutely worst.
Man.
The Bible says in Romans 5 verse 8 that when we were yet in sin,
yes,
God demonstrated,
uh-huh,
He put on display His love for each and every one of us.
Well.
I'm talking about somebody that loves you when your breath bad. That love you when your hair nappy. You won't got to put on no weave with God. You can go bald headed if you want to. God will rub your bald head. As a matter of fact, He'll touch that head and make some hair grow on it if you want to. You know how to say it to me. I'm not asking you to be in an abusive relationship. I'm asking you just for once in your life to really consider what love is.
Man.
Paul says that this love that I'm talking about suffers long. It's kind. I like this. Love does not envy. You don't have to compete with God. You don't have to. In some of your relationships, you spend all your time competing against one another. You trying to be smarter than him. And it's the male and the female war. And she's trying to be smarter than you. And y'all just keep right on to it's a big division that come about in a relationship. And then the devil can just walk right in. Because every time he come home, he got to prove he's smart and make good decisions. He got to prove that he's a man. And every time you come home, you got to prove you're the woman. And so you're going to tell him just how dumb he is. And I ain't cooking today. I work just like you work. You know, I tell you what. When I got one, you won't get none tonight.
Preach.
Love any of not. Love vaulting not itself. Love doesn't say, look what I did for you. Love does not start reminding you all the stuff I've done for you. Love don't take account or a record of things that go on between us. Love is not puffed up. Love don't sit around and say, if it wasn't for me, you wouldn't have nothing. Somebody, love don't act like that.
Amen.
Love. I like the next verse. He says, love does not behave unseemly. Satan is the only one that